So in terms of turbine combustion, what I have given you just then was just sort of very general overviews of turbulent flows, how it's generated, what are the parameters characterizing it, right? Scale of turbulence and the intensity of turbulence. Basically, two parameters, how it does. And then how you can solve it, right? And then you cannot do it rigorously in terms of DNS. You can do it, but under very restricted conditions. So any realistic situation, you might have to, you know, for those DNS, it's very useful. But you use that to understand the basic physics of the character of turbulence. It'll be impossible to use DNS to simulate a whole combustor. Yeah. So when you simulate a whole combustor, then you go to other methods, right? LES and LES so far is probably the most popular one. All right. Now, here I want to, some of you have seen that. Basically, you try to characterize a turbulent premix flame, how it's like. It's called the regime diagram. I think it was postulated in the 1980s, and it still sort of pervades the literature. You open up turbulent flame papers, then frequently you see this diagram. Basically, it characterizes the type of turbulent flames. How you characterize it, you on the X scale, you characterize the characteristic length scale, for example, okay, of your turbulence relative to your flame thickness, for example, all right? So, and then the vertical scale, you characterize the intensity of your turbulence, which is your turbulence intensity relative to your laminar flame speed, all right? So basically, you just have two parameters always, right? So one is, say, a length scale, one is an intensity scale. So if you do that, I don't want to go over this with you. You just roughly see how things go. And then when you have this corner, it's basically laminar flames. Because this one is sort of Reynolds number, is one situation. So your length scale is rather small, and your intensity is small. So this is basically laminar flame. Now, if your intensity is still not too large, but your scale here increases, then you get what's called the wrinkled flame. So your turbulence basically wrinkles your flame, right? Wrinkles your flame. So you get more surface area, for example. And I'm going to explain some more. And then in here, you get what's called a corrugated flamelets. So instead of laminar, let me show you what's the difference. You're talking about, here is sort of, we say it's a wrinkled flame, okay? So here's the flame, reaction zone. Here's the whole flame zone. And here is the turbulence. It sort of wrinkles it. Then if the wrinkling is strong enough, then you call it corrugated, okay? So then say, okay, what's the difference? They're all wrinkled anyway, right? Well, there's sort of subtle difference because, for example, if you want to describe this one, it's sort of single value function, but here it's sort of multiple value function. It folds into itself, The wrinkles try to fold into itself. And the real consequence, eventually, if it holds it strong enough, this guy can go into here and then it closes it. Right? Then you get unburned pockets, things like that. Right? So that's the wrinkle flame region. And then finally, you end up with this region. Your turbulence eddy gets small enough, or your intensity, then it goes into your preheat zone structure. Okay? Goes into a preheat zone structure. And then eventually, it's strong enough, even goes into your reaction zone structure, and your flame is gone. Your flame loses its identity, okay? It loses its characteristics, right? Turbulence basically goes inside, and you don't have any kind of laminar flame transport. So that's generally what it is, and this is what's called the regime diagram, as I said. So, you know, as you keep on increasing the intensity, it goes from this weakly distorted flame to strongly distorted flame, and you go to the reaction sheet, and then this one is distributed, where's the reactor, basically, okay? So this one is basically, you don't have a distinct flame structure. Kind of homogeneous, all right? But it's not homogeneous in the sense, there's no motion. Actually, there's a whole bunch of motion inside, but the motion is so strong that it's like homogeneous mixture, right? Yes. I cannot, in a sense, I cannot comment on it. Those are unsolved problem. People are still working on it, right? You read papers, this, as I said, this diagram is very famous, and people will put their data points here and there, here and there, here and there, and then try to see whether this or that, this or that. That's all I can say. I'm sorry. I'm as much confused as you are, okay? And also, seriously, I don't mean to be sarcastic, serious. It's, yes, because it's, you know, for example, all these things, it did not account for flame movement. Why does it account for flame movement? I've told you, right? For the stagnation flow, I increase the stretch, okay? The stretch, the flame will move because the velocity is stronger here, okay? Then it'll move to the back. It wants to maintain its own burning rate. I told you, flame is a live animal. It doesn't want to be killed. You want to kill it, it moves away, it says, I'm fine here because I have my laminar burning rate. My laminar burning velocity will balance the flow. It goes to another place to balance it. Goes to another place to balance it, okay? So the flame will move around. This thing does not account for this. Does not account for the flame movement. It just say, it assumes you have a flame here, you stretch it, the flame will sit here and let you stretch. It doesn't. And that's why the existence, a lot of experimental data right now, it's sort of indicating this, okay? The flame structure, flame, it has more, it's more prevalent than what's shown here. Mm-hmm. It tend to exist in a wider region, the flame. I suspect one reason is because it actually will move around. Okay? The dynamics of flame is not here. And then also, I'll just talk. I cannot finish everything, it's all right. Maybe later we can schedule a Skype, I'll give you guys seminars. Flame from instability. I told you about all these wrinkles. It's nothing here. It's not in the stack. That's why I hope you guys know the flame fundamentals, even the laminar flame, they are relevant. Try to improve on this diagram. I think that's the really, a lot of people recognize we need to improve this diagram. It's a long time, about time to really get more serious, okay, with this. So I hope I have given you some, you ask me a question, I give you some more things for you to think about. Okay? All right. So anyway, that's how people try to right now understand the thing. Right. But also the flame, I told you that the flame is all this interpreted is based on one step reaction and something. I told you about the chemical structure of flames. Okay? So if you think of flames, actually the flames the reaction is everywhere from laminar flames. Mm-hmm. And I also tell you about the low temperature flames, where you put it here. Okay, so life is not that simple. So you have to put it some more in here, but then you're making it more complicated, which isn't good, because at the beginning of the lecture, the course I say simplicity is better, always try to be simple. So complicate it and then simplify it eventually. Okay, that's you guys' job. So, all right. So I think that's all I want. So let me skip this. Let me go to the bound. There's turbulent burning velocity. Okay, let me just say a little bit here. First of all, we talk about laminar flame speed, laminar burning velocity. All right, that one I mentioned to you, it is a fundamental property of a mixture, the laminar filling speed. All right? For a given mixture, I can measure it, I can determine it, and that's it. I can tabulate it. All right? Methane, air, stoichiometric, that's the frame speed. It's a property of the mixture. So it's got fundamental meaning in it. Turbulent flame velocity is not a fundamental property of the mixture, right? It's a fundamental, it's a property of the mixture together with the fluid mechanics. The fluid mechanics, of course, can vary all over the place. So you want to recognize that, right? It's not a fundamental property. But nevertheless, it's useful to have some idea of how fast a turbulent flame will burn for certain kind of turbulence, okay? So what people, this is also some experimental techniques. Right now, this is what people usually, again, a popular diagram is to plot the turbulent flame speed versus laminar flame speed as a function of turbulence intensity, and then the result is something like this, okay? As you increase the turbulence intensity, it goes like this. And it keeps on increasing, but the increases go slower, slower. And this is called the bending effect, okay? So you do turbulent flame, you really try to study this, right? And then when you get some results, it shows this one, you feel very happy, you say you are discovering great things. But being a skeptic, I'm not a skeptic, but certain times you need to be, you say, what do you expect? If it doesn't bend, you expect go this way? Do you expect to go this way? You increase turbulence, it'll go up the roof? There's no way. It has to. If this, either this way or this way or this way, I'll choose this way, right? I mean, when you try to do something, eventually it's gonna saturate or something like that. So there's nothing fundamentally significant with the bending effect. That's what you should get when you increase the turbulence. All right. I've been saying too much about my belief today. Careful. So to describe turbulent burning velocity, there are two major classes of doing it. One is the reaction sheet description. All right. Basically, it is falls into this category. Your flame, your turbulence actually enters in your preheat zone. Okay? Your turbulence is sufficiently strong, it enters into your preheat zone. So then the way to interpret it is that I've told you the flame speed of laminar flame is controlled by reaction and diffusion. So basically what that is, basically the diffusion zone, the molecular diffusion, in laminar case, it's molecular diffusion. If it's a turbulent case, then it's turbulent diffusivity, okay? And you guys know how to estimate those turbulent diffusivities. So basically for those cases, then you use the turbulent diffusivities, okay? So the flame speed would then, right? I've mentioned to you the laminar flame speed is the square root of the diffusivity, okay? And turbulent flame speed is the square root of turbulent diffusivity, which is analogous to the kinematic, turbulent kinematic viscosity, and which is given by this particular parameter. So when you take the ratio, then you ended up with square root of the Reynolds number of your turbulence. So that turns out to be rather nice, actually, right? So in this limit, reaction sheet limit, right? Again, as I said, in this limit, then it should go like, if you know your turbulent turbulent Reynolds number, then it's a square root, this one. Okay? So that's one way to interpret it. If you end up with the flame sheet description would be, you know, whenever you have a flame sheet here, okay? It's a flame sheet now, basically. So the turbulence eddy does not go into your flame structure. You do that, then if you look at this case, look here. Here's the flame. The flow is going this way. It wrinkles it. Okay. So if you think, then this it's got a, some kind of turbulent velocity, turbulent frame speed. This guy sees it. And then the area it covers is A here, whereas this one is actually wrinkled. So the local velocity is the lamellar frame speed, the local velocity, whereas the area is A of this all wrinkled. So if you equate the two, then what it says is that the ratio of your turbulent frame speed over your lamellar frame speed is the area of the turbulence over this. So again, it's obvious. The increase in the turbulent velocity is due to the wrinkling of your area, your frame surface area. So if that increases, you increase. So everything proportional to the area, okay? So a lot of theory have been formulated basically in how to count the area, how to calculate the area. So I will just mention several of them. One is just a vector description. You say there's a curved frame, and then basically you have the lamellar frame speed here, which is normal to it, turbulent frame speed here. And then if you just do a geometrical consideration, then you ended up with this one. It's a square root of 1 plus velocity fluctuation versus frame speed to the square, okay? So it's a simply geometrical consideration. So then you can say if you take the limit of weak turbulence, then you end up with this one. It's quadratic dependence when the intensity is weak. And it just goes like this one, you take this away, right? So the linear when it's very large. Now, this is an interesting result because you say this is the ST over SL. It goes like U naught prime over SL. So your SL, SL cancel. All it says is your turbulent frame speed is just your turbulence intensity. Your frame has no effect. The frame, because this guy is wrinkling it so much, the frame basically just follows the turbulence. Okay? So that's what you have. So that's one kind of description. Another description is you look at surfaces. It's a fractal. You guys all know what I'm talking about, fractals. Fractals describing the geometry of irregular shaped bodies. So you use a fractal to describe the frame surface. All right? So I don't need to go to this detail. So basically, you say the turbulent frame speed, basically it's proportional to the area of the turbulence, which would be relative to, for your fractal, you have the inner cutoff and outer cutoff. But when things are really large, then this irregular shape doesn't matter. And there's some inner cutoff. Inner cutoff, in our case, would be the Kolmogorov scale. So basically, the ratio is the Kolmogorov's length to the inertia length range. And then it ends up to be Reynolds number 3D. D is your fractal dimension over 4. All right? Again, just recognize that the fractal you can, there's a theory of fractals trying to describe the frames. All right? And then there's renormalization theory. All very elegant theories. Basically, it says if you have something with wrinkles of different scales, so you keep on averaging it. One scale, you average to another scale, average to this scale, finally to this scale. All right? And you keep on doing this, then you end up with this. And then the result shows it's rather interesting. You see the ST squared log ST squared going this. Doesn't it look familiar? I've been telling you guys that F squared log F squared equals something. Those kind of things come back again and again. All right? The idea is because everything is exponential, this. All right? And when you move the exponential over, then it becomes a log. So it goes into this. And then this shows bending. Mm-hmm. So it's formulated by a couple of guys. They're all from Seldovich. Sivashinsky formulated that. He's the last student of Seldovich. And there's another one, another student. OK, so that's it. OK, let me quickly go to boundary layer. Boundary layer flows and this. I won't be able to cover everything. Let me just think very quickly. I want to cover two things, two concepts, okay? One concept is similarity issue of boundary layers. The other is jet stabilization. Jet flow is a boundary layer type of flow. We talk about stabilizations, okay? So let me just cover these two things. Now, the first thing is important, the issue of similarity. Who has taken boundary layer theory in your flow mechanics? You guys have? Flow mechanics, all right. So, okay, go back to think your flow mechanics class, all right? You spend a lot of time to derive solutions which is similar. Does it make sense to you? Your Blasius equation. Does it make sense? Blasius equation? What is it? Final equation is what? F triple prime plus F double prime equal to zero. Huh? Rings a bell? But anyway, okay, we'll see. So, Blasius equation. And that's an ordinary differential equation. Okay? Right? Depends on eta. F triple prime eta, F is equal, or ordinary differential. The problem with boundary layer flows is inherently two-dimensional. It's a boundary layer. You flow this way, your transport is this way. Your viscosity acts this way, your flow this way. Inherently two-dimensional, okay? So it's inherently, first of all, talk about mathematics. So inherently, it is a partial differential equation. And it turns out to be a parabolic partial differential equation, all right? But then you try to seek solutions such that the flow is what's called self-similar. So the variation in one dimension is proportional to the variation in the other direction in a certain way. So that then it becomes ODE. Just one, right? So that's mathematics. Physically, of course, it's very profound. That means that the behavior of your boundary layer evolves similarly as it goes down the flow. All right? In a similar fashion. So it turns out there's a huge amount, the boundary layer flow. You guys look at the books, right? If you identify, sort of discover a boundary layer flow, you have a name attached to the equation. You can be famous for life, things like that, like the Blasius, right? Okay? So what I want to impress upon you guys, or demonstrate to you guys, or show it to you, how to look into the issue of similarity when there's chemical reaction occurring, all right? And I should show you that in most cases, the similarity is destroyed. You don't have similarity. But there are some cases you do. Right? Under what cases it does. Right? Okay, so that's fundamentally it's an important concept. So let's first of all look into the characteristics of boundary layer flows. What boundary layer flow is based high-speed flow adjacent to either a solid surface or a slower stream, right? So that it slows down the flow. So that it stops to meet the boundary condition. High-speed flow velocity is zero, so the boundary condition has to be zero here. No slip boundary condition, right? So it slows down the boundary. So now, the thing is, for small viscosity, as is for air, so the adjustment occurs in a thin layer, in a very thin layer, the boundary layer, such that mu du dy is order one. Okay? Mu du dy is order one. Now, this doesn't make sense for me, for you, for whatever, because this is dimensional. So, but I say ordering will be defined later. So roughly just conceptually. So. Another general concept is that the viscosity coefficient, thermal diffusivity coefficient, rho d, they are all similar for the thing. So therefore, boundary layers for momentum, heat, and mass are of close magnitude. Here I want to mention to you, the boundary layer theory which most of you have studied is only for momentum, okay? What we're studying here, what we're thinking about is general. You can momentum boundary layer, you can have a thermal boundary layer, heat boundary layer. Momentum boundary layer is where the velocity changes. Thermal boundary layer, temperature changes. Mass boundary layer, concentration changes. Okay? They're all boundary layer. You want to think in the general sense. That's why I say when I use the word diffusion, I say diffusion of anything. Diffusion of momentum, diffusion of species, and diffusion of temperature. right? But the main thing is that they are of equal magnitude. So actually, their thickness is about the same. So I can just talk about momentum boundary layer. OK? Moment boundary layer flows are intrinsically 2D. So what it means is that diffusive transport is predominantly, of course, different. It's predominantly in the y direction. Right? It's a very thin boundary layer, so the gradient here is very strong compared to the gradients here, in the streamwise direction. Right? So, let me see. It's two dimensional. When I say two dimensional, I have the diffusive transport this direction, that direction, convective transport this direction, that direction, four terms. Okay, right? But I've also told you that the diffusive transport in this direction dominates over diffusive transport in this direction. This is the streamwise direction, that's the normal direction. So this is, because it's very thin, you see, so this is dominates over that, so I can neglect the streamwise transport in the x direction. So when I do that, then I end up with three terms, d square, dy square here, and the d by dx and d by dy here. So the problem becomes parabolic. You know what I'm talking about? Bounded, partial differential equation, you have d square, dx square, d square, dy square, right? So if they plus elliptic, minus one of its, they're hyperbolic. If you just have one of it, it's parabolic. So it's parabolic kind of equations. So basically, then it's parabolic equation. Then you want to seek similarity solution. Basically, instead of varying x and y, you want it to vary just with one parameter. There's some scale parameter between x and y, so that it only changes with either, okay? Now, abundant similarity solution exists for non-reactive flows, and such a similarity is mostly violated in non-reactive flows, okay? And I'm gonna demonstrate that to you, and not only demonstrating this to you, but also actually indicating to you a more profound concept that means that when you have processes other than fluid mechanics, which is chemical reaction, or you can have other processes, your boundary layer assumption usually fails. Okay, which is a very important concept you want to know, because if you are not aware of it, you have studied boundary layer flows in your heat transfer course, boundary layer flows, there's a lot of it. So you tackle some new problem, you right away assume boundary layers might not hold, okay? So here's all sorts of boundary layer flows, okay? Let me demonstrate this to you. This is important. Let's just look at the governing. Let's just look at the x momentum. You guys, Navier-Stokes equation, obvious, right? This is the convection term, inertia term. This is the pressure. It's the viscous term and the pressure. Let's don't worry about the pressure. Your viscous term is all here, all right? And wait a minute. So first of all, we recognize, let's take a dimensional analysis, a length scale analysis. D by dx is, I say, 1 over L, d by dy, 1 over delta. Delta this way, okay? So if I non-dimensionalize my equation here, then I have three groups of terms. This group is sort of u infinity, some kind of reference velocity, all right, over L. And this has L over delta, U over L, and then this Reynolds number, and then this another one, okay? Very quickly. So those are three groups of terms. Now, again, you recognize this is the first order term. This is d squared by dy term, okay? And all of these terms, they have d by dx, d by dy, and d squared by dx squared. Whichever. First of all, you compare this guy to this guy, all right? If it's not clear, look at your notes. This guy is the same except this one has one more term, L over delta squared, okay? This term, L over delta squared. So this is a general sort of non-dimensionalization and scaling, but now I have this one, L over delta squared. So what do? I invoke boundary assumption, which is one assumption. I say delta over L is much less than one, okay? Basically, I'm talking about it's a boundary layer. The thickness in the y dimension is much smaller than the dimension in the x direction, okay? Same boundary layer. So I make this one assumption, which is the characteristics of boundary layer. Right? So once I do that, then I can drop this term. All of them, okay? Because they are, this is bigger than that. This L over delta squared. This is, you know, so it's a huge term. I drop this one, okay? And then the second thing to recognize is that if you compare this guy with this guy, that's the inertial term, that's my viscous term in the normal direction. Mm. Then you say, well, I have U infinity L squared, U infinity L squared here. And then I have this guy here, L over delta squared. Wow, this is a large number. I just use this one to drop this one. So maybe I can use this one to drop that one, okay? But I cannot, because temporarily don't worry about this term, because there's only two terms here, okay? A equal to B. A equal to B has to balance. A has to equal to B. So these two terms have to be the same. So what does it mean? What it means is that since this is very large, this is very large, so this guy has to be very small. This is Reynolds number minus one, I think. This guy has to be very small. All right? So that means Reynolds number has to be very large, so that this is order one, so that this one balances with that one. Okay, so this is a concept I want you guys to realize or recognize. You have two terms, they have to equal to each other. So they have to balance, okay? They have to balance each other. So that gives you the proper ordering. So what this means is that if I make just one assumption, boundary layer assumption, this is less than one, then if I balance the inertial and the viscous term, that means Reynolds number has to go like L over delta square. They balance, so this has to be much bigger than one. Okay? Is this clear? So what it means is that for boundary layer flows, the Reynolds number has to be very large, which you all know, all right? That's the fundamental assumption of boundary layer. The key point I want you to recognize, you make one assumption. Some people, they want to show they are smart. They write a paper, say, assumption one, assumption two, assumption three, assumption four, and all these kind of things. If you really know the thing, you say, why is that? Because one implies the two, two implies the three. You don't need that. You just need to say one. Okay? So remember this, all right? Okay? You really understand the problem, you just write down the basic thing. That's all you need. So I'm saying that I'm only making one assumption. I can make this assumption. I can say large Reynolds number. If I make large Reynolds number, then automatically implies this is very small. Okay? It doesn't matter. Make one assumption. Make the minimum assumptions. Any good theory is that. Minimum assumptions. Crucial assumptions. All right? Okay? So I want to impress this upon you guys. So we're talking boundary flow. In general, it occurs in many, many problems. So the assumption is that boundary layer, so this dimension is much smaller than that dimension. That's it. And then it implies large Reynolds number flows for this. All right? Okay? Done. All right. So if I do that for the, you know, I did it for the momentum, you can do the same thing for the energy, for the species. They all end up with this operator. Right? The operator which I have now is this one and this one. Right? Inertial term and viscous term. And the energy, it's the same operator. Then on the right-hand side is my reaction term, right? We know that. Okay. Now, what I want to discuss. So I want to transform to the boundary layer variables. It's a little bit math here, but that helps with the thinking. And if you guys have studied boundary layer theories, you know what I'm talking about. All right? Basically, instead of going with x and y, I go with two other variables, okay? Eta and s. And the eta and s go the other way, that basically put the problem in a better, better way. We have to define a string function that takes care of the continuity equation, all right? And things like that. So let me get a sip of water first. So it's actually rather simple. I transfer from x and y to s and eta. All right. So s is basically sort of roughly like x. Eta is sort of roughly like y over root x. Okay. So eta itself will eventually become my similarity variable. Right? I mean, some of you recognize what I'm doing here with the boundary layer theories. So mathematically, there's nothing big deal. I'm transforming from x and two variable to two variable. Okay? And anybody can do it. I mean, just take a little bit of patience. So you do that. People discovered long time ago. So when I transform this to this new boundary layer equations, then I get, okay, it's a little bit long, but don't get intimidated. So you have this eta, this eta, this s, this eta, this s, and then this is the forcing term, okay? This is the pressure gradient outside. And in terms of energy, this is the reaction rate. So this is the transport operator, and this is the source term. Okay, how you drive it. Now, I'm trying to get similarity solutions. Basically, it should, eventually I'm gonna prove to you it varies, the property varies with y over root x, it varies with, okay? As it flows down, it doesn't change. If you plot everything y over x, it keeps on going down, it doesn't change, all right? That's what's called similarity. X will change, y will change. That property, y over root x, doesn't change. Mm-hmm. It's the same thing as heat conduction equation. You guys study heat conduction, right? Heat conduction, there's T and x. So the solution, you go back to check. What is it, the T over x over root T or T over root x? T over root x. Okay, it's heat conduction, the same as that. Right, your heat conduction is d squared dx squared d by dt. Huh? So same thing. So actually, your professor might not have told you that, but implicitly he's making a similarity description of the flow, heat conduction. So okay. So eventually, I'm trying to get this. I'm trying to basically to let it just depend on eta. So if you look at this, depend on eta. So this guy is, they depend on S, I don't like them. Depend on S, I don't like them, okay? So one way is the brute force way is that I just drop the dependence on S. If I drop the dependence on S, then it only depends on eta, then it becomes ODE rather than PDE, right? They all depend on eta. So mathematically it's simpler. But also conceptually, it says the profiles remain the same. So I want to drop this S. The problem is I cannot drop S, you see, because the source term depends on S. My reaction rate depends on S. So if you want to drop S, you say, I don't want it to depend on S. I just want it to depend on E and S. But the source term says, look at me. I vary with S. I'm going to keep on giving you a characteristic of S, as if S is X. Going down. So it's not self-similar. All right? That's the source term. That's what it does. All right? So what it is that then you say, let me look into situations in which my source term does not depend on S. okay? Then it's okay. So let me demonstrate to you under what condition. It doesn't depend on S. So let's look at just case without combustion, okay? This is just fluid mechanics. Go back to your boundary layer theory, fluid mechanics, all right? If it just depend on, I want it to just depend on S. Doesn't depend on S, this whole thing. So if you look at this situation, I just want this guy, okay, the one on the right-hand side, doesn't depend on S, so it's a constant. Then you can convince yourself the velocity, outside velocity, in your boundary layer flow, okay, normally vary with x. This guy only goes like x to the m. Only a flow like this will give you a self-similar solution. And this is the class of Faulkner-Skahn flows. Anybody recognize this? Anybody remember this? Recall this? Faulkner-Skahn flows? Come on. No? No? Yes? Why not? This is Faulkner-Skahn flows. All right? Faulkner-Skahn flows is u equals x to the m. And this is the class of flows in which you get boundary layer. Similar. So similar flows. All right? For this kind of flow, force flow. There are other kind of flows. The Faulkner-Skahn flows. This one. Okay. So anyway, I think it's nice. Then we are dealing with chemically reacting. I'm sorry. We are dealing with chemically reacting flows, right? So in addition to this guy not depending on S, I also require this one, this reaction term doesn't depend on S. So this particular guy doesn't depend on S. All right? So not only the flow is self-similar momentum-wise, but also in terms of heat and mass transfer-wise, it's also self-similar. So then you recognize for chemically reacting flows, for that equation not depend on S, you have a flow like that. So this guy should be constant, then the flow is x over ax. Okay? It is a particular subset of Faulkner-Skahn flows where m equal to 1. So let me recap. For Faulkner-Skahn flow x to the m, Faulkner-Skahn flow x to the m, the flow, boundary layer flow is self-similar, x to the m. If in addition I have chemical reaction occurring, okay, then out of this m, x to the m, out of this m, m equals to 1, chemically reacting flows is self-similar. Okay, so in general then, for x equal to 1, u equal to ax, the flow is self-similar for the momentum and for energy transfer. For the species transfer, okay? So, voila, you guys, you guys recognize this? X equal to AX, huh? Well, we studied what, yesterday or the stagnation flow? Isn't it nice? That's why stagnation flow is so powerful, in addition to what I mentioned to you before. I mentioned to you it's a Taylor expansion like this. But this guy itself, for chemically reacting flows, chemically reacting boundary layer stagnation flow or counterflow, whatever, so similar. Okay? That's why so many people, quite a lot of places, use counterflow to study chemical reaction, the flames. So similar. Okay? By the same token, alerting you, you use some other kind of flows, okay? It might not be self-similar. You be careful. your flow could mess up with your interpretations, your jet flows, some other things, boundary layer flows. All right? So I hope I can give you guys this concept. And you have to respect the presence of terms like this, okay? The this kind of source terms. So now, as I said, a lot of boundary layer type of flows, they are not similar. Every case you have to look into it. Why is it so? Because once you got other flows, for example, you have a dusty flow, your boundary layer flow over desert, okay? You got all the particles in your boundary layer, right? You got the drag, viscous loss, all those particles. So then in your problem here, you get some kind of terms representing your drag, or your heat trend, you get transfer term here. So all of those terms is messing you up with this one. All the flow is radiating. That's okay, very high temperature flows. It's radiating. Radiation, so you don't have a reaction term, but you have a radiation term. Again, you end up with this kind of problems. Okay? So do not casually assume a flow is self-similar. Okay? So what are we doing? We have time. We're up to another one. What time is it? Time for another break? Huh? Time for another break? Let's do another break and then I'll quickly wrap up.